twist villains are characters that you thought were good throughout the whole movie, but then at the last second, they turn out to be evil. The whole time. The era of the twist villain. That was a thing, but I don't really think it is anymore, almost. Disney and Pixar really liked twist villains for a while. And these ranged from pretty good to Emperor Zurg from Lightyear. I thought it could be fun to rank the twist villains, judging them by how good a villain they are, how well implemented the twist was, and, like, other things, probably. Some villains are not well implemented. You know who I'm talking about, but we'll discuss that in a minute. I want to get some honorable mentions out of the way, and by that I mean one honorable mention. And that's Syndrome, who would easily dominate the list if it weren't for one little thing. He does not count to me. Buddy Pine was introduced at the beginning as an annoying, toxic fanboy, and then halfway through the movie, he returns, revealing himself as the mastermind behind the entire Omnidroid plot. It's a character we thought wasn't evil, who turns out to be evil. Twist villain, right? I mean, not really. Like, yes, it's a twist, but it doesn't affect Syndrome much. Plus, his devolve into supervillainy was largely off-screen, which isn't a problem for the movie, but does prevent him from appearing on this list. So, yeah, let's just get into it. Yippee!
Future! Future!
And the worst twist villain in Disney and Pixar history is... You know exactly who it is. First off, this movie sucks. Second off, Zurg's identity is one of the most disappointing, underwhelming, confusing reveals in movie history. So it's Buzz from an alternate timeline where he just found all this evil alien tech. Instead of trying to use the tech to complete his mission, he used it to try and steal the crystal he needed to complete his mission. Why is he evil? Our Buzz is kind of short-tempered, but he's not one encounter with alien tech away from becoming a supervillain. Plus, he's just boring. He's not menacing. He has some good voice acting, but other than that, I genuinely almost forgot to include him. This movie sucks. Don't watch it. It's not even funny bad. It's just dull and boring, and that sucks for a movie that had potential to be really cool. Zurg sucks. Good lord. Moving on. Cars 2 is one of the worst Pixar movies, but everyone knows that. Miles Axelrod is the villain. Whoa. I mean, look, this movie's kind of a massive joke, and if you expect me to seriously analyze whether or not Miles Axelrod is a good twist villain, you'll be entirely correct in your expectations. So he is foreshadowed in idiotic ways. He pees himself and makes it look like Mater did it. The idea of him pretending to be an electric car when we know the criminal mastermind has an old-fashioned engine is okay on paper. I mean, what do you want from me? It's Miles Axelrod from Cars 2. He's the villain of Cars 2. He is a car crime boss who tries to blow up racers because he's butthurt. I'm not spending another second talking about Miles Axelrod from Cars 2. I'm sorry. I can't bring myself to care about Miles Axelrod from Cars 2! Moving on. Zootopia is a movie I'm really mixed on, because while I really like its characters and world, I kind of think the allegory falls apart if you think about it for longer than 5 seconds. But I guess I can't judge too much. What I can judge, though, is the reveal of who is behind the big mystery we've been following. Assistant Mayor Bellwether sucks. Do you get it? The real predator was the shy, whittle sheepy. Don't judge people by how they look, yada yada, whatever, this reveal sucks. Not only is there absolutely no foreshadowing or buildup besides the fact that Hitman is a ram, also she has such a drastic turn from her previous persona to her villain persona. A problem we'll see a lot more of in the next two options in an arguably worse way, but at least the twist is better with those. Anyway, yeah, this movie's fine, but I hope Zootopia 2 has a better villain heading it, because this ain't it, Chief.
Bill Nye the Science Guy!
This and 11th place are basically tied. Neither of them are horrible, just very, very, very lame. So in 12th place, we have Robert Callahan from Big Hero 6. You know, from the meme.
That was his mistake.
Anyway, Robert here functions. His design when he's in his supervillain suit is really, really cool, and I don't see enough people complimenting it. Like, he might be the coolest looking character on this list. That being said, there's also this very subtle foreshadowing near the beginning, which I actually do really like. When Callahan makes his resentment of Kray obvious, it hints at his true intentions to get revenge on Kray, while also, for this section of the movie, makes the main red herring Kray look worse. I really dig it. That being said, this guy's transition from pre-villain person to villain persona is ridiculous. He goes from chill, normal guy to this raving lunatic with the most incomprehensible plan in the world.
You sent my daughter through a portal, so now I'm gonna use that portal to suck up your fancy new building.
Like, what? What? That's your revenge? That was just for an alternate pitch. Kray actually is the true villain, and the climax is about the superhero team helping Callahan go through the portal and save his daughter. The twist is that the villain guy was actually just a sad man, and Kray was the one who should be punished for carelessly experimenting with portal tech in the first place. This would also ease Hero's conscience, because he could help another person grieving and fix things. I don't know, it's just a real missed opportunity, and probably the most underwhelming villain on this list. But at least he looks cool, and the reveal makes sense when compared to Zurg, who is the most incomprehensible freaking decision in Disney history.
Well, excuse me, princess.
Prince Hans, yep, the one who kicked off this whole twist villain era. Okay, there is pretty good foreshadowing here, which bumped him up a Callahan. He pretty effortlessly takes control of the kingdom, and then later very subtly attempts to murder Elsa with the chandelier. That's a cool touch. Okay, but the actual reveal is such a joke. Why does he become this mustache-twirling psychopath? It's like going from, like, a sweet little puppy dog to Moff Gideon from The Mandalorian. It's such a contrast between personalities, and there was zero hinting that he was this much of a creep. I guess you could say he was just faking it. But what's really annoying is that his fake chemistry with Anna is better than her actual chemistry with Kristoff. It just is. Here's how you could have fixed this villain. Just clue us in that he's up to something, and also make his evil persona less that. Anyway.
Maurice, old and crazy.
Charles Muntz from Up is not my favorite. Now, I must admit, Muntz is miles better than the bottom five. That being said, I still don't think he's great. The twist itself is fine. It's more of Muntz himself. He's just kind of a flat villain. Plus, while it's pretty dark that he went insane and killed all those explorers, he's also not very deep or layered. He just really wants the bird. Muntz does get some bonus points for his terrifying introduction, though. That scene is legit super menacing. Like, oh, he's unhinged, run! And maybe I'm a bit mean for keeping him this low, but shut, it's my list. He's still fine. I don't have anything else to say about him. He's kind of just, yeah.
Technology!
Screenslaver from Incredibles 2 has the reverse effect as Muntz, where the twist is super predictable and kinda lame, but I actually really like her as a character and villain. She has a very casual way of saying things, and it's pretty intimidating. And every time she gets to act villainous, it's pretty effective. And her motive is foreshadowed well through conversation. I like her a lot. The problem is that it's the most obvious twist in the world. See, the problem with this movie is that there's only two suspects for who the bad guy is, and she's always placed in the shadow. Like always, it makes it really obvious. The real twist should have been that Evelyn was using the Screenslaver as a prop to get Elastigirl popular. She'd still be a villain because she'd be hurting a lot of innocents while doing so. So Elastigirl would inevitably take issue with this, and that's when Evelyn uses the goggles on her and the other supers. And then the climax could largely be the same, but instead of the supers declaring their own anger, it's one last fake Screenslaver attack. I know that would have to change her motive a lot, but whatever. And then the movie ends with supers still being illegal because they chose to take out Evelyn instead. Could have been an amazing arc, but as is, yeah, it's just okay. At least she's a really fun character. Tafiti is a very underrated villain from a pretty underrated movie. So, admittedly, she's a bit weird, and it's debatable whether or not she counts, but I think she does. After Maui stole her heart, Tafiti became a big scary lava monster, destroying everything, but Moana and Maui don't know that. The twist is very simple, but I think it works for this film. And it leads to a great climax, and overall, I like it a lot. Simplicity does hold it back a smidge, but it's executed very well. Miles better than Evelyn. We're in the better section of the list now.
Let's try all that again.
Future!
Meet the Robinsons is an even more underrated movie compared to Moana. Like, nobody talks about this outside of the one meme. Now, I think the twist here is great. It's super goofy. Makes sense for the movie. And besides that, Doris is super intimidating for a hat. That's the weirdest sentence I've ever said on this channel. What the? I think the main issue here just comes from the fact that the twist happens really late in the film. I wish we spent a bit more time in this dystopian hat future for sure. It's really cool and spooky. I also think the way Doris is defeated is kind of underwhelming, and it happens really quick. Like, the actual scene where they defeat Doris is about as long as this little blurb where I'm talking about her. That being said, I do like how Doris relates to Bowler Hat Guy's arc, and Bowler Hat Guy is an amazing character. I mean, look at him. He looks like Waluigi. Yeah, a lot of bonus points for the creativity here, and Doris is just a pretty fun character. So, yeah, there you go. It's really high. That's why. Let's move on.
My diamond!
Atlantis: The Lost Empire is the most underrated movie on this whole list. Go watch it. It's amazing. Please, go watch it right now. So Rourke is a good twist villain, right? He's revealed at the perfect time in the story and is given ample time to be evil. Plus, it's cool how realistic he is. His motives are greedy and exactly what I'd expect from a corrupt leader going on an exposition to an expedition to an alien society in the real world. You know, if we found one. He's very intimidating, very cool, bit stiff in the personality department, but that really doesn't matter. Yeah, he's great, and so is this movie. Go watch it. Okay, moving on. Toy Story 2 is the oldest movie on this list, I think. Wait, let me double check that. Okay, yeah, it is. Cool. Okay, moving on. Toy Story 2 is the oldest movie on this list, and it's also one of the best. I don't think the Prospector has quite enough screen time with his true colors revealed. Like, it's like 5 minutes. But regardless, he's still great. He has a very believable motive, it's foreshadowed really well with the whole TV thing, and he's pretty intimidating. I like how often Toy Story villains get fates worse than death. Like, good lord, just kill him now. Another thing that really makes him work, and we'll see this again with the next Pixar villain, is that there is an active antagonist in the movie already in the form of Al, so it's not a big deal that he's revealed at the very end. I cannot emphasize enough how small the stakes feel without villains in a lot of these other movies, especially this abomination. Good villain in a near-perfect movie. Like, I rewatched Toy Story 2 recently after considering the weakest one for my entire life, but nah, man, this one might actually be the best. It's really, really near perfect. Oh my goodness gracious.
Welcome to Mario Kart.
Wreck-It Ralph is a movie I always really liked, but have grown to appreciate more with the abundance of terrible IP crossover movies, including this movie's sequel. It's a really good movie with a really great villain. King Candy is kind of stretching it because he's actually the villain throughout the whole movie. We see that he's up to no good pretty early and he manipulates the characters around him and causes a ton of trouble. But it is a twist that he was actually Turbo, the video game character who went rogue, so heck, I'm counting it. Such a delightful vocal performance, and such a sinister character, and he's such a little slime ball. Like, he's probably the character I want to punch in the face most out of anyone on this list. Why does Hans get punched, but this guy doesn't? Have you seen Ralph's gorgeous giant hands? Those massive, strong hands? Anyway, yeah, Turbo's absolutely devious, and he's a little piece of human garbage. And a remarkably well-written, well-used, and entertaining villain. I'm so glad he got eaten by the Cybug and— oh no! Yeah, he got bumped up a spot thanks to the climax. This terrifying bug monster version is so cool and so scary that I couldn't help myself. Absolutely stellar final boss fight. One of the best in Disney history. In fact, spoiler, but this is the best twist villain in Disney history. The top three are all Pixar's handiwork. Mr. Water News is a very unique twist villain because he doesn't really change face. After the reveal of his true colors, he's pretty much the same character, just with new context. Like, he does get really angry at the end, and he has that really deranged rant about kidnapping children. But, like, he's the exact same character otherwise. And that was when he was under a lot of pressure. And just like the Prospector, there's an active villain throughout the first hour of the movie as well, so we don't feel the stakes are too low. Water News is revealed pretty much at the same point in the story as the Prospector, but is used a lot more after the reveal. He doesn't feel underused at all. The foreshadowing is a bit weaker, but otherwise, yeah, man, Water News rocks. This is also a near-perfect movie, and the villain is one of its most expertly crafted aspects. Aspect ratio.
And the winner of the best murder mystery of the year is...
Coco is a film I've grown to love more and more with time, and its villain is one of the aspects that's gotten the most better, the most more I think about it the most. Like, yeah, why doesn't he just tear the photo? I don't know. But literally every other aspect of Ernesto de la Cruz is perfectly realized. He doesn't have, like, a top-tier motive, it is just the typical greedy villain shtick, but he also doesn't really need one because he is, much like Turbo, a slime ball. He's probably the actual villain on this list I want to punch in the face the most. Plus, I adore the actual reveal scene. It's deeply unsettling, and the face he makes is... hoo boy! I also did not see this twist coming, honestly, because I didn't think there'd be a villain. The movie was so focused on the family drama, I thought that'd be it. But no, this absolute monster is the reason the family was torn apart, and it's really, really sad. Now, admittedly, he does have a harsh transition between pre-reveal persona and post-reveal persona, but honestly, again, it works here. Ernesto is a performer. He's always putting on a show. And before the reveal, everything he says and does is so boisterous. So, look how epic I am! Ahaha, I'm a great musician! Plus, it's unique that the motive here is covering up a crime from decades ago. It's so different and dark compared to most characters in the list. I considered putting him at the list topper, but... I feel like most people agree with this, but regardless, yippee! Lotso Huggenbear is basically what all twist villains should strive to be. He's revealed early enough, so he's plenty of time to be evil. And the first act and a half of the movie are so character-centric that the lack of evil energy isn't a problem. It's also compelling anyway. So Lotso adds a whole lot of spice to the story, and he is super evil. Like, surprisingly so. I mean, he leaves the gang to die in a fire after they saved him.
Where's your kid now, Sheriff?
Yay, another one I want to punch in the face. At the same time, he has a really interesting and sad backstory that ties into the themes of the Toy Story series so well. Plus, he's marvelously entertaining. I mean, there's such a malice there, and he gets tons of time to be this total evil jerkwad. Great stuff, and easily the best twist villain to come out of either Disney or Pixar. Is what I would say, but it turns out there's actually one villain even better than the already perfect Lotso. Yes, you heard correctly, the true winner. The greatest twist villain in Disney history is without a doubt Grover Fishoder from the Bob's Burgers movie. Fox is owned by Disney. This is a Disney distributed film. It counts. This is a perfect villain in every way. His acting, his song, his true evil malice. A true icon of cinema, planet Earth, and our dimension as a whole. Need I say more? Anyway, the twist villain era gets a lot of flack, but like most of these ended up being pretty good villains, and in a few cases even great. There's a few impossible to repair pieces of other garbage, but mostly ended up being pretty good. A lot better than having every movie try to be subversive and ending up being really predictable and lame and basic. Yeah, this was fun. See you next time. Bye!